All right, so today in this lecture, we are going to start the lipids and waxes. We already know a brief introduction about the lipids. So basically, what we are going to study in this lecture is that to study the meaning of lipids and how they are very useful in our daily life, and also the fatty acids, waxes. So basically, these are the things which we are going to have to study in this lecture. And also the types of the molecules which are present inside the lipid and understand in the role in human body. So basically these nutrients are having a great diversity of functions in our body. Like if we are talking about the proteins or carbohydrates, lipids, fatty acids, they all have their unique role to perform. So as you already know about the roles of the protein, carbohydrates, like nanolipids. So now we have to see how the lipid can profile our body in a different functions. So first, we know the lipids as a heterogeneous group, and that is not soluble inside the water. So as a water is a polar solvent, but lipids are only soluble inside the non-polar solvents like the ether, chloroform, benzene, because of their oily and greasy constituency. So if anything, not only the lipid here, if anything which has some greasy appearance, okay, any kind of oil or anything which have the lubricity in them, so these kind of thing cannot get dissolved inside the water because their bond of hydrogen bond, they cannot be breakable. Or if the bond cannot be breakable, so they cannot be solubilized. So that's why they are insoluble in the water, but they can be solved, or you can say they can be soluble inside the non-polar solvents like ether, chloroform, and benzene, and also something like hexanes. Hexanes is the best, I think, solvent that can mobilize the lipid and waxes inside them. So what we have to study here, for example, like fatty acids, fats, oil, waxes. So in this, we are going to take the fatty acid, waxes, and some other constituents which are the derived lipid. So if we see the very fundamental value of how lipid composed of, the lipids basically composed of the three molecules, that is carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. So the normal, this molecule composition is very fundamental for life. Like we need carbon in everything. So that's why, because our body is organic. So if anything is having the organic constituency, the carbon is a basic molecule which have to be present. Hydrogen is a bond that is the, you can say, that is the backbone of everything inside our body metabolism. So that's why hydrogen and oxygen, these three things are fundamental, and these fundamental things are the basic component of the lipid here. The last thing is air gravity. This is also important that we know that how the gravity upholds the lipid composition. So if we are talking about the how gravity works on the lipid, so like the gravity composition of lipid is 0.1, 0.8. So this is very to the nutrition to nutrients, like protein have a different 1.3, I think, and lipids and the carbohydrates and vitamins. So these are having a different variety of the gravity, how gravity upholds on them. Next, the types. There are three simple types of lipid. First one is simple lipid. Second is compound lipid. Third one is a derived lipid. If we are talking about a very primitive kind of lipid, very simple one, okay, so these are the only esters of the fatty acid with various alcohol. So I already told you that lipid is very, you know, that is not a stable component. So if anything which is very unstable, so they cannot be live alone, okay, they cannot live lonely, so they have to make a bond. So in that case, if they are having, or this is a mandatory condition for them to make a bond, at that time fatty acids need something to bond with. So on the basis of their bond formation, like how they bond, with they bond, and how their bonding formation work, on these basis we derive the lipids in three forms. Like if we are talking about simple lipids, they are just the combination of ester fatty acid with alcohol. Second, if we are talking about the compound lipids, so compound lipids is a, like you can say, there should be addition of different functional group, or you can say that there have to be a addition of the additional group in the already present ester fatty acid with alcohol. Means here there will be three composition molecule. One is ester fatty acid plus alcohol plus additional group. Three composition matter will be take place in the formation of the compound lipids. So you can see the examples here, like phospholipid, glycolipids, sericulocyte. So these are the lipoproteins. So these are the basic kind of compound lipid. Third one is a derived version. So if we can hydrolyze, or if we can, sometimes we esterify, if the hydrolyzation of this compound lipid can be done, then they will be formed the derived lipids. So what we have to do for changing the compound lipid to the derived lipid, this is only one reaction we have to perform here. Okay, this is one thing we have to do here, that is hydrolyzation. If you do hydrolyzation of compound lipid, okay, if you are doing a hydrolyzation process and doing inside the compound lipid, then that compound lipid will be converted into the derived lipid. So this is not very way more different from the compound lipids. This is just only one difference between them, is about the reaction of getting hydrolyzed. So if any compound lipid get hydrolyzed, they will be converted into derived lipid. Is that clear? Is there any confusion in simple compound and derived lipids?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Next, we will see the fatty acids. So these are the building blocks which form the lipids. So they are having this monocarboxylic acid, RCOH group, with long hydrocarbon chain. Okay, their chain should be long. I will show you the diagram here. Actually, this is a diagram of fatty acid, waxes, steroids. It's not very clear. Is it clear to you all?
Yes, ma'am.
You can see here, if we are talking about a wax, we will talk about wax later. So you can see a very long hydrocarbon chain. Fatty acid, this will be a singular but long hydrocarbon chain as in the waxes. But when we will talk about the wax, they are always having the two chains facing each other. But in the case of fatty acid, there will be only one chain. Now you can see here the steroids, they are the derived one. So they having a multiple addition of compound here, one chain, two chain, three ring, fourth ring. So they are having a multiple type of compound inside them. That's why they are the derived lipids. And you can see also the vitamin A complex here. So vitamin A is a partial fatty acid. It's like this one chain. This give an idea of the fatty acid look like, but they also having an additional compound which actually make that fatty acid conversion into the vitamins. So these are the basic structure which have been followed by when the lipid formation happen inside a plant body or human body. So these fatty acid is called alkyl group, okay. So this is a name of the fatty acid. They can be called as alkyl group when it is a part of the ester. If they are a part of ester, they will be known as a alkyl group. In biological system, fatty acid usually contain an even number of carbon atom. Okay, so whenever we talk about that, they are the organic components. And if they are organic components, they are supposed to have carbon atom inside them. So basically, if we talk about the ester composition, and if we see what are the number of the carbon atoms present inside a fatty acid body, then they are the typically between the 14 to 24. 14 to 24 carbon number can be present inside a ester family. So the most common fatty acid having 16 to 18 carbon. So you can see here the most common, like palmitic, oleic acid, linoleic acid, stearic acid, they all have a majorly common kind of carbon number, 16 or either 18. So these are the though very abundantly used carbon number in the form of functional lipid formation. So you have to remember the carbon number, okay? And next, the fatty acid, they are amphipathetic molecule. Like amphipathetic molecule, how they are having a chain, they are having a long chain, as we already seen in the diagram, and they have a long chain of hydrocarbons. So the long chain and one end, okay, the chain has two ends, okay, on both the sides. So one side is hydrophilic or polar, and the other side of the hydrophane chain are the hydrophobic or non-polar, okay. This hydrophobic chain here, sorry, the hydrocarbon chain here, one side will be hydrophilic or polar, or another side will be hydrophobic or non-polar. Means there is one side of the molecule which can be digested into water. Okay, that's why we can call them the polar molecule or hydrophilic, because it's water loving. And second one, that cannot be dissolved inside the water. So hence we have to use some non-polar solvent or non-polar solutes to make it activity downwards. So in physiological condition, fatty acid found in ionized form. So we already talked about it, like the ionized form, what happened in that ionized form, the any kind of charge was present inside a molecule, that at that case we call them the ionized form. So basically, why we call them ionized means why we mention this, that a fatty acid found in an ionized form. So basically, the main reason behind the mentioning of their ionized form is like whenever the thing is getting charged, there is a two type of charges present in any molecule. Okay, there can be a positive charge or there can be a negative charge. So if they're having a positive charge, so they might be attracted by the negatively charged bodies. But if they are having a negative charge, so they might also be attracted by the positively charged body. So that's why, because they have to make a bond, or if they have to make a bond, they have some attraction power. Okay, without getting attraction, they do not make a bond. So if something have to make a bond, they do need to other things to have to close to them. So that's why they have to, presence of a charge is a fundamental reason for getting fatty acid present in the ionized form. That's why they are present there in ionized version for getting inside a bond. Now these were all the characteristics which we studied about the fatty acid. Now the importance, if we see here, what are the importance of the basically fatty acid? So the most important fatty acid is the triglyceride, okay? There also a whole metabolism process of triglyceride, which is present in the fat cell, or we can also call them the adipose cells. So these adipose cells are basically the storehouse of triglyceride, okay? And this is the very important molecule for producing the calories inside the body. Okay, whenever anabolism process happens inside the body, anabolism means break out the complex thing into the simple thing. There is a two process, okay, catabolism and anabolism. Catabolism is the build up one. The small molecules will come together and build one thing. Anabolism is break out something, okay, a big molecule, and they are breaking inside a small molecules. So triglyceride is a kind of complex complex compound here. So complex compound, if they are going to break in the small cell on a small partition, so that simpler form of that triglyceride will determine to produce the ATP. So you can see the energy. So you can see in the later verse, the complete oxidation of three fatty acid of a triglyceride release 9 calories per gram. So you can see the how much it's really a big amount for producing that much calorie from just from the 1 gram thing. So the 9 calories per gram by the triglyceride, in contrast, you can say if we compare their calorie outburn in the comparison to the carbs and the protein, we just release 4 calories per gram. So hence, this proved that the fatty acids are the more calories production as in comparison to the carbohydrate or proteins. They are building blocks of phospholipids, glycolipids, lipoprotein that found in biological membrane. This is also a very important feature of the fatty acid, that they made the biological membrane. Biological membrane means cell membrane. See, you know that either it is in the case of plant cell membrane or animal cell membrane. Both have lipid is a very important constituent of their cell membrane composition. Or if we see at the molecular level of the lipids, only the fatty acids are the major one which plays a very important role in formation of the cell membrane. So cell membrane, how the fatty acids present means in which form. They are not present in the core fatty acid because they cannot present alone. They have to be in a bond form. So what bond form is present inside the cell membrane, you can say here they are present in a glycolipids, okay, means glycogen. You know, cell wall is have the glycogen inside them. So the glycogen plus lipid, if they are present in the combination version, we can call them the glycolipids. Lipoprotein, lipid and protein, the combination in lipids and protein is called in the lipoprotein. And the phospholipids. The phosphate is also very useful constituent of the cell membrane. Anyone know what is the function of phosphate in the cell membrane? What do phosphate do? Also, this is very important in functioning of photosynthesis. Anyone have any idea what does phosphate do? Phosphate function.
Ma'am, phospholipid plays important role in forming the permeability barrier, ma'am, in cell membrane.
Okay.
And intercellular organelles.
Okay, they are playing role in the intercellular organ, but what actually phosphate do actually? When the time of signaling process happen, like something come at the cell membrane, okay, they do need to pass a signal. So whether the cell membrane open to take that particular thing inside or excrete something, what is the main function of cell membrane? To absorb something or excrete something. So at that time, when they are absorbing something or they are excreting something, at that time phosphate play a major role, because phosphorylation of that particular signal produce the activity in the cell. According to that activity, plant cell membrane or animal cell membrane can get open, or it can absorb something, or it can excrete something. So that's why these phospholipid, glycolipid, lipoproteins, they present inside the cell membrane to help the regulation of the wall to perform their function. So this is very important function of the fatty acid which they perform. Next function we see here, eicosanoids are the polysaturated fatty acid which serve as hormone. Okay, you know what is the function of hormone. They are very necessary inside the body of the humans because hormone regulate most of the activity of our body. So if we see, mostly the hormones are the protein ones. Okay, protein are the play the major function in the hormone synthesis. But when we talk about their signaling process, like transfer of that particular signal of that hormone, in that case we use the eicosanoids, and that is a fatty acid. This is an important function as a hormone, so you just have to remember it like the name eicosanoid, which help as a are the basically what are they? They are the polysaturated fatty acid which serve as a hormone. Next is Fatty acid derivative act as an intracellular messenger is IP3, that is a DAG. That's what I was telling you about in the cell membrane process. So these IP3 or DAG, these are the two secondary messenger basically, which give the message to other cells for their initiation of the activity. If any activity has to be performed inside in cells, so there should be a messenger to go and give the cell a message, then please activate your activity. So at that time, these fatty acid, or example of fatty acid, you say enantiomer 1,4,5 triphosphate, that is called IP3, and DAG, this is called diglycerol. Okay, so these two things have a major role in secreting the message from one place to another place. Fifth one is here, deficiency of EFA. EFA are the essential fatty acid. Like some things which are very two type of measurement of importance in our body, essential or accessory. So if we are talking about the essential one, and if we are having a deficiency of that essential fatty acid in human diet, so they can be result in sterility, kidney failure, skin problem, and also the hard skin, or sometime it is also the blood problem. So these are the problems which can be faced if we are having a deficiency of essential fatty acids. So human diets should be very transparent and very, you know, manageable, that they are having the all the nutrition in their diet. Otherwise, they have to face several problems caused by them. Provide the insight to many diseases like obesity and anthracnosis, and also they are the key to make the disease. Also the obesity, the fat, if our body having a too much fat, that is also a problem, because all the major process in our body gets slowed down. Means basically extra fat always produce many problems in case of the lesser fat. So they have to be present in an accurate manner, not too much more or not too very less. So this is very important if we are taking some food inside our body that have to be healthy, not as anything which we are eating, because our body is not dustbin. You have to see what you are eating before you eat. Hydrogenation of unsaturated fatty acid, convert oil to solid fat at room temperature. This is the basis of manufacturing edible vanaspati ghee, margins, or incredible cheese, cotton seed oil. So these are the basic thing. If what happened inside a plant, you can see hydrogenation happen. Hydrogenation of unsaturated fatty acid. So basically hydrogenation means hydrogen removal. Okay, water removal and hydrogenation is hydrogenation removal. At that time, if fatty acid are facing that hydrogenation process, they basically convert oil to the solid fat only at the room temperature. Oily is a liquid thing, okay? Oil, what is oil? Oil is a liquid thing. But they can do it, they can convert them into the solid fat. So there are many kind of vanaspati ghee and oils, or you can say they are a little solid form only at the room temperature. Or they can also make this kind of thing from the cheap cotton seed oils. Means if you can see, this process is not mandatory for a very high class seed oils, but also very cheap like cotton seed oil can also perform that kind of function only in the presence of the fatty acid. Physician recommended taking PUFA to those having high blood cholesterol or cardiovascular disease. So what is basically PUFA? That is the prescribed version of fatty acid. Okay? Not every fatty acid, if some person having a problem of cholesterol or cardiovascular disease. Okay. So, and if they are taking a normal form of the fatty acid, at that time, they are taking it is more dangerous. Okay, if they are taking a lot of fatty acid inside, or their body already facing the problem of high blood cholesterol, cardiovascular diseases, so at that time we needed to take a fatty acid which is not harmful, it should be designed to reduce our disease, not to enhance that. The cleaning action of the soap is due to reduction of surface tension of water by particles. Also, you can say whenever we clean our hands, so if there any oil, if you make any oil inside on your hands and you go and wash it out, then also you can see that the soap is reduced surface tension of the water by fatty acid. So that's why this is also happened, means they can reduce things, okay? And reduction is very good, because if the reduction do not take place, many reaction do not perform their work. So if something can a reducible thing, we can make things out of that. So that's why reduction is important. Fats, now if we talk about the fats here, there will be three type of major fats: true fats, natural, neutral fats, and triglycerides. So in three of them, the basic or the good one are the true fats and TGL. Neutral fats are just neutral. They are just present here if sometime what happened. Body cannot recommend the true fat or TGL biosynthesis. They cannot do that because of any other activity which is performed there. So at that time, these neutral fats come into the function. Neutral fat basically non-active throughout their life, but sometime when the body is needed, at that time when the true fat cannot be useful, triglyceride fat cannot be useful, at that time this neutral fat can be helpful and perform the body function. Now the properties of fat, the fatty acid has been completed. Now we will see what are the properties of the fat. The basically the fat of the animal and plant origin are mixture of different triglyceride. Okay, if we are talking about the fat, then the basically what is fat is? Fat is a mixture of different triglycerides. Plant have more unsaturated fatty acid and animal fat and saturated fatty acids. Okay, so we are studying the fats now. So basically what are the fats? They are the combination of triglyceride, and commercially if we wanted to use, we can convert them into the oils and the fats, lipoproteins. So these are the basic things which can be, even we can turn it on the room temperature, or we can also liquidify in the oil at the 20 to 30 degrees Celsius. So we do not, they are not very demanding, that they need very high profile things to perform their function. So they can easily work on the normal parameters. Now the property of the fat depend upon the chain length and their degree of saturation. This is important. So whatever the property fat have to be performed, this is basically depend on what kind of length of their chain is present of the hydrocarbons. Next is the hydrolysis. Hydrolysis is when the water component and ester from the ester component have to be loose out, like lipase hydrolysis. The ester bond so that the triglyceride form three fatty acids and one cholesterol. This is the basis of fat digestion. It means like there is a triglyceride. So triglyceride having the three fatty acids. Okay, this is a combination of triglyceride that they have to be made a bond by the three fatty acid. But if they get hydrolysis, if their hydrolysis has been done, they are forming a one additional glycerol. So that glycerol, basically their function is to perform for the mobilization of that three fatty acid. Like if three fatty acid are present in the triglyceride, but if they are not working, what they are of use? They are no use of that triglyceride if they do not perform any kind of function. So basically when the hydrolysis happens there, they get them into the functional mode. Next is the oxidation process. In oxidation, yeah, these are the properties, okay? These are the properties which can be performed by the fat in the body. Like you can see here, what are these properties? First, the normal properties of the fat. Third one, from the hydrolysis. Fourth, you can see here, oxidation. Fifth will be here, saponification. Next, renicidity, that is very important. We will discuss it. So now we will see that the how the oxidation process. So on the outer mitochondrial membrane, okay, oxidation process happen inside the outer mitochondrial membrane. So mitochondria have two membranes, is the inner membrane and the outer membrane. So this process, the oxidation process, happen at the membrane of the fatty acid, outer membrane of the mitochondria, in which the fatty acid first linked to a coenzyme, and that coenzyme is a basically a designed version that is only function for the fatty acid, and we name them the thiokinase. Okay, the thiokinase in the enzyme which basically present on the outer mitochondrial wall to get attached with the fatty acid. This is called the fatty acid activation. When this thiokinase get connected with the fatty acid on the outer membrane of the mitochondria, so this process will be called as a fatty acid activation. Means at that time, fatty acid get activated to perform the function. So subsequently, the activated fatty acid enter into the mitochondrial matrix where beta oxidation takes place to liberate the energy. So these all oxidation process that happens on the outer mitochondrial membrane. But after getting activated, when the fatty acid get activated by the combination of thiokinase, they have to enter inside the mitochondrial matrix, because only inside the mitochondrial matrix they can perform the function of beta oxidation. Basically, what is beta oxidation? Beta oxidation is a function for the ATP generation. Mitochondria is a powerhouse. You all know that mitochondria is a function for the ATP production. So how this ATP production takes place? So these fatty acids play a major role in production of ATP, or you can say the energy. First, they do oxidation on the outer membrane, and they get inside and do the beta oxidation process, and then they release the energy. So at that, in this manner, fatty acid get oxidized. Next property here of fatty acid is saponification. So basically, saponification is a process of formation of soap by boiling its fat or oil with alkali like KOH, NaOH. So basically, if we want a fat is to convert it into a soap, you use the soap, right? They are the converted form of the fat, but they have to mix with the alkalis like KOH and NaOH. So these play a very important role in the soap formation also. Next property of fatty acid is rancidity. This is basically the development of unpleasant odor and taste of a fat or oil when kept for a long time or exposed to air, moisture. So you see it at your home also, if the oil is getting very old, okay, like there is a 2 years or 3 years you didn't use the oil or just kept it, so after some time it smells differently. Their taste can be changed, their odor, their smell can be changed, and sometimes their color also change. They get darkened in color. Like if you are having a mustard oil for like 2 to 3 or 4 years, you will see after the 2 to 4 years, their basically their morphological features will be changed. their color change, their density might be changed, taste change, odor change. So this process, when a oil get converted on the way, on some time, at that time what we call that process is rancidity. Means they are rancidity over the time. So what happened in this process? Rancidity is caused by microbial degradation of fatty acid. As you know, the microbes are present in the environment, all the surrounded by us. So what happened, these microbial basically degrade the fatty acid which has been present inside that oil. So if the fatty acid get degraded, so obviously they lost their function. So fatty acid was doing work for maintaining the properties of that particular oil. But now as a fatty acid get degrading, so hence the all the characteristic which was very, you know, specific for that oil, that is also going to be the change. So that's why we do not have to store oil for a very long time, or it must not be open. It is either it is very tightly sealed up, so sealed up oil can not be get degraded by microbes. But if we are going to use the open oil after some time, it does not taste or it does not colorize the same as it was before. Next is your acid number. So it is the number of milligram of QH required to neutralize a fatty acid present in 1 gram of the fat. So this property, acid number. So if someone asks you what is the acid number property of lipid, so basically you have to tell them that these are the number of KOH required, okay, potassium hydroxide required for the neutralizing the free fatty acid present in 1 gram of fat. So if 1 gram of fat will be neutralized by some potassium hydroxide, so what will be that number? That number will be known as the acid number. So basically that indicates the degree of rancidity. So whatever the process you studied earlier, rancidity, so this is the degree of the rancidity. Next is iodine number. It is the number of grams of iodine absorbed by 100 grams of fat. So in this you can see here that the means the iodine will be present inside the body. So if the number of iodines observed by the 100 gram of fat, it indicates the degree of unsaturated of fat. Sometimes iodine is mobilized with the fat. So whatever or quantity of the iodine which is mobilized with the fat is called as the iodine number. So means it simply says like how much iodine has been mobilized inside the body. Now the waxes are basically they are also a lipid derivation. So they are the esters of long chain fatty acid with the more hydric alcohols. So I already showed you the diagram here. Okay, waxes have a long structure, but they have a double chain, not a single chain like a fatty acid. So the fatty acid and alcohol in waxes vary from 24 to 36 carbon. Carbon is number is very much here. It's like 24 to 36 carbon. And they form waterproof coating on the surface of the plant and animal. In botany also, I told you about what is the function of waxes. Basically, they coat on the surface of the plant and animal surfaces. So hence, the water cannot penetrate inside. So they are the water coating surfaces. Up here, there are some example of the waxes are present here. Like bee wax. As a wax which is produced by the bee inside a honeybee. Carnauba wax, it is occurs in the coating of the leaves and basically the palm trees in Brazil, and it is used in the automobile polishing, and they are the hard one. This is the hard wax. Carnauba wax is the hard one. That wax is not as soft as the bee produced wax. Third one is spermacti. That is the sperm oil wax. Means this is obtained from the sperm of the whale, from the head. But it is a lubricating wax. It is very lubricative in their surfaces. Next, you can see here. Lanolin. That is a wool fat, basically. So it is secreted from the cuticinous gland of the fur-bearing animal. means like the animals which present in a very cold region. So at they are having this particular wax inside their cutaneous gland. So this is obtained from there, but it is very rare to find. Next is Vax-D. It is secreted by tuberculosis and leprosy causing bacteria. It is major cause of the disease. So Vax-D is basically the wax for the disease. That's why we named them the Vax-D. So they are basically, we can obtain them from the bacterial, but this is harmful and cause disease. Succinemin earwax. So every person or every humans or animals, they are having this earwax inside our body. We also have the earwaxes. So earwax also present, but it is the mostly that is the composition of the irrelevant things in our body. So it is just like a waste material. Not very harmful, not very useful in any kind of work. Paraffin wax, it is obtained from petroleum. Like you can see the candles, okay? So whatever the candle preparation has been done, that was done by the paraffin waxes. Cutin and suberin. Cutin and suberin, they are also the part of the plant cell membrane. We know that the cuticle and the suberin, they are the deposition molecules. So cutin is basically, this is also a water repellent one and present inside the cuticle of the plant and form the epicuticular wax, or it is very a major component of the cell wall formation. Next is suberin. So you know the suberin is basically present on the coccyx. I think I told you about like the sclerenchyma cells. Okay, sclerenchyma cells have deposition on their cell walls. So this suberin is a major component of their deposition. They have the formation, or you can say they have the deposition in the form of suberin. Also the coccyx and Casparian strip of root epidermis. They are also having the suberin on their cell walls because it is water impermeable and check infection in the plants. So obviously if they are present on the wall, there is no water penetration can take place, and also there will be a very less chance to get infection in the plant. So they are a very useful one. Phospholipids. Okay, this is the derived lipid. I already told you in the initial division when we are studying about that, how the lipids can be the derived one. So these phospholipids are basically the phosphatized version of the lipid. So these are the esters of fatty acid with glycerol and sphingosine containing the esterified phosphoric acid. Basically, what you have to remember it in here, that they are the esters or esterified phosphoric acid, which is derived from the glycerol. Okay, if they are derived from the glycerol, also they will they are be called as like the phosphoglycerol saccharide and the glycerophospholipids. So glycerophospholipid will be better because you will not be confused, because by the name you can identify that they are having the glycerol inside them, phosphate inside them, and the lipid also. So all you just have to remember in phospholipid that they had basically the component, their component is the phosphate and lipids. This is also acid which is very useful in the formation of the phospholipids, and that is phosphatidic acid. Okay, take in mind also that the phosphatidic acid is very useful in making the simple phosphoglyceride lipids. So these are just some simple example by which they can be derived, like phosphohydrochlorine, lactisinin, halomines, cephalines. So these are the basic, they're nothing, you don't have to remember these all, but what you have to remember that the phospholipid are basically the composition of phosphate lipid, and if they are derived from the glycerol, then also the glycerol is present in them, and this acid, phosphoidic acid, which is basically responsible for the formation of phospholipids. Now we see the function of the lipid, phospholipid. So this is the intermediate in the synthesis of triglyceride and phospholipids. Obviously, that is a major tool, or you can say this is a major thing between the triglyceride and phospholipid. Phosphatidic acid is found in bacterial wall and in a mitochondrial wall. So these acid, which help to make the phospholipid in function, they are present inside the bacterial wall and inner mitochondrial membrane. Leccini act as a surfactant that lower the surface tension in long alveoli to prevent the collapsing of alveoli. Means they basically reduce the surface tension in our lungs. Okay, in our lungs, what they do, they reduce the surface tension. So because they can reduce, that's why they prevent the collapsing of alveoli. If there will be no reduction of the surface tension there, then our alveoli can get collapsed and it can be dead, or soon we can be dead. So that's why this is very important in lung function. Phosphodiesterase enantiomer, this thing is internal messenger, also work as a secondary messenger, and this very helpful in the hormone action. So as we already studied it, like how secondary messenger do the signal work, and they transfer the message from one place to another place. And in this, these two things, IB3 and DAG, these are the most important kind of lipid, which plays a major role in cell signaling process, secondary messaging, and the activity of a particular cell to initiate. So these are the very important role. Last is the plasmogens are important phospholipid of brain and muscle. Plasmolysin, they are also, basically they also reduce the surface tension in muscle tension. So that's why the muscle of brain can be relaxed, and the muscle in our body, they do not have a strain inside them because of these phosphate regulate their activities. Now, this is all about the phosphate. If you guys have any problem, you can ask phosphate and phospholipid waxes.
No, ma'am.
Okay, just solve your 2-3 questions here. It's very easy. So with first question, this molecule acts as a molecule chaperones to assist the folding of protein. Which one is that? Folding of protein. It's like I just told you, in the cell membrane. Who will help there? Folding of protein done by?
Ma'am, carbohydrates.
Lipids. अभी तो पढ़ा था हमने.
Yes.
Lipids help them na fold the particular protein, so that's why they can easily mobilize the function. Okay. Second, which of these not a lipid? ये तो easily बता सकते हैं. Which of these is not a lipid?
Ma'am, protein.
Okay. The abundantly distributed enzyme in germinating seed and adipocytes, which one? Lipid protein concept. What is a lipid enzyme here? Which one is? What the name suggests? Lipid enzymes.
Mems. From cellulose.
Lipid enzyme. How can the cellulose be lipid enzyme? Lipase, huh? First,
yes, ma'am.
Lipase. Okay. Next is beta oxidation of fatty acid occurs in which? I just told you, beta oxidation. In which happen beta oxidation of fatty acid?
Ma'am, Ma'am, it's mitochondria.
Yes, it is mitochondria. mitochondria perform the beta oxidation process just to release the ATP. An example of this Cessna wax, whatever will be it, soft wax, liquid wax, hard wax, archibacterial wax. Which one will be? Pronus, Cessna wax is the hard wax. Okay, soft wax is the honeybee which perform, and liquid wax can be done by the from the plant one, or archibacterial wax which cause the disease, that the bacterial wax. So obviously that will be the hard wax. Next you can see here, in fact the number of OH group can be expressed as अभी पढ़ा ना हमने कौन से चाहिए वाला OH group
मैम
इन फैक्ट फैक्ट
मैम
ओके इट इज द एसिटाइल. Okay, if they are producing the iodine, then they would be iodine number. Okay, answer the seventh question. Rancidity of lipid rich food stuff is because of what happened in the rancidity of lipid?
Ma'am, it's.
Density, what happened here?
Ma'am, oxidation breakdown.
Oxidation of the fatty acid.
Yes, ma'am, breakdown of oxidation.
ठीक है ये और क्वेश्चंस में तुम्हारे इस पे प्रूव कर दूंगी वहां से देख लेना और ये कुछ इसमें तुम्हारी बुक्स वगैरह भी मेंशन है पीपीटी के अंदर कुछ एक्स्ट्रा इफ यू वांटेड टू गेन समथिंग. You can read out these research paper and also you can go through these books. They're very good on the nutrient content analysis, proteins, carbs, and everything. Okay, if there is no confusion, you can go.